Hi.
Hi.
So, this is very much like the other two films you've made. No.
Well, to me, you know, people, that's maybe on the surface, mm-hmm. but there's other people who say they could tell it was me throughout, but just using different styles. Mm-hmm. My favorite directors are people like Sidney Lumet, Robert Altman, mm-hmm. People that worked in completely different styles depending on what the material needed, mm-hmm. but the things that interested them were the same, which was these very isolated people trying to, you know, answer the question of whether they're going to be alone or not alone. Mm-hmm. Short Bus, the realm of conflicts was sexual, but really the basis was isolation, mm-hmm. That they desperately were trying to, you know, through all these scenarios of bad sex, trying to find someone, and in the end, to me, it's rather serious when there's this attempted suicide and the characters, in the middle of the blackout, find a weird kind of unexpected interweaving. Same with Hedwig. On the surface, campy rock and roll. At the basis is this love story about the myth we seems to resonate across cultures, which is we're split when we are young and we're seeking to complete ourselves with our other halves again. Mm-hmm. And along the way, there's different styles of ways you can investigate their story, musically, very self-conscious camera, comedy, animation, but it's still the same characters. And Nicole Kidman's character, Becca, is one and the same mm-hmm. with Hedwig. You know, this rather steely, yet sensitive, trapped in her own skin type of character of Becca Corbett, who's dealing with the tragedy of loss of her child.
Well, it's almost to me like an actor who you're, you know, used to doing a certain thing, or and then you see them do a role where they strip away all their tools. Because essentially, you know, this movie is so stripped down and raw that, you know, I guess the distractions of rock and roll, the distraction of sex, the distraction of that is gone, and you're really, as a director, just getting to that core. I mean, that's all you have, is the actor in the frame and the silence, mostly,
and
the few words.
Yeah, that's true. When I read the script, it was so well formed that I let them know that I really thought the camera should be invisible. For various reasons. I just didn't want the director. You could have done like beautiful shots and dolly shots and Scorsese out of control with the story as well.
Right.
But to me, we didn't have much time, and that requires time. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, I just wanted it to be about them. Composition was sometimes random. Mm-hmm. It was whatever situation we could get the actors in to being the most relaxed, the most natural. If that meant having two cameras and we're not having perfect lighting, you know, so be it, you know. Two opposing cameras when people are seated across from each other. You know, if we were talking, there'd be another camera here, which you rarely do in film because different lighting.
Right.
You know, you're suddenly backlit, overlit over here and over there. But I had a cameraman who worked on all my other films who was aware of that. We had to shoot on the red camera, digital camera, for financial reasons, but we used really old film lenses from the 70s, which softened that digital harshness that you often get from the red camera, though the red is better than most. So again, trying to reduce anything that you, between you and the characters was our goal. Same.
So you're kind of making a narrative documentary on some level.
Well. I mean, no, it's quite structured still, but it.
You using a script, but your style was to. I mean, it's beautiful looking.
It was. I mean,
it's a gorgeous looking film.
But it wasn't. Yeah, you're right. We're not. I wouldn't say the documentary. I mean, there's a certain amount of times where it's like, let's get what we can handheld. But obviously, all documentaries are not handheld. But there was elements of Daco capturing it shooting rehearsals. We never shot. We never did unshot rehearsals. You know, mm-hmm. rehearsals were always shot because mm-hmm. you never know what you get. First takes are always better. Mm-hmm. Knowing when to say nothing to Nicole because she's very self-sufficient. Knowing mm-hmm. when to guide her. Other actors needing a lot more, wanting more and more. Mm-hmm. Some people liking comedy on the set before, you know, Nicole preferring a serene kind of environment. Mm-hmm. Diane Weiss, one thing, the kid, the newcomer, mm-hmm. needing a lot more, cuddling and touching and talking mm-hmm. and shoring up his confidence and letting, mm-hmm. urging him to go to these emotional places while planes are going overhead every 40 seconds in Queens. You know, it was a slog. But
is it different for you having actors like Aaron and Nicole, who are so experienced and bring a certain degree of celebrity to it? I mean, are they just other actors who have
celebrity hasn't really affected. I'm sure the celebrity will help us sell it.
Right.
But in terms of celebrity on set, that the only different thing was that, you know, there was some paparazzi
right.
trying to grab her that we'd have to deal with and have security. But in terms of their skills, which is separate from celebrity, mm-hmm. That was a dream because, you know, they was always encouraging them to surprise me. Mm-hmm. And Nicole always had a very different approach per take. She knows that the variety is important mm-hmm. in the editing room. And we did a little bit of looping and shot one shot. That was mm-hmm. our only reshoots was a single shot of her. Mm-hmm. that we didn't have time to get on the day. And so we were very economical about, and she was very focused about what we needed. Staying near the house, there was no trailers, you know, had a little room in the house for her, and no wigs, you know, keep it moving, keep it real, keep it looking real. And she does look very real in this, you know, more down to earth than we've seen her. She's a woman of her age now. You know, she looks her age and looks great.
So how did you get involved with this in the first place? This is not your normal route to a film.
Yeah, well, you know, I do get offered scripts a lot since Hedwig, but I'm very picky. Mm-hmm. You know, I've been offered gigantic, you know, films as a director, and even I was offered acting roles. I was offered one of the X-Men. I was like, I'm tired. I know I'm going to have to be in front of a green screen all day. It's like, luckily I have a low enough rent. Uh-huh. And overhead that I didn't have to take everything I wanted.
Do you like the idea?
Target commercial campaign. It's $1 million. I'm like, yeah. I don't know if I want to put my year. I need this year to be about writing. So I had the luxury to be able to say no to millions of things. In this case, it was a yes because the script screamed out to me that I needed to be part of it. I had a brother who passed away when I was 14. In similar circumstances of accident, and it brought it all back, and we weren't really allowed to talk about it back then, you know, and this was my way of purging and, you know, thinking about it, and I want this film to be super useful to people who have experienced any kind of loss to move into another realm of thinking, and, you know, which will make it hard at first to say, oh, I don't know if I want to see a film about, it's going to take, you know, people like you and friends and tweets and this and that to go, well, if you see one drama this year, this one is not going to drag you down, it's going to pull you up, and please go see this one.
Yeah.
You know, it's a challenge, but I think we can do it.
Well, I imagine for a 14-year-old with a brother, that it's, that the Diane Weiss mother-daughter relationship with Nicole is really more of your experience than the rest of it.
It was.
Because that question of how much grief and who's responsible for what grief and all that is very, very tricky.
It's true, and the religion was definitely part of it for me. It was a comfort for my mom, but not for me. And, you know, I probably can trace my lack of belief in the God that I was taught about to my brother's death instantly. This is just, still doesn't make sense to me that but if God is good, why that type of thing would be allowed to happen? Mm-hmm. The lessons learned are not commensurate with the event. But for others, it is useful, and I totally respect that, as long as, you know, there's other ways of expiating the grief than just, you know, he's an angel in heaven. There's got to talk more, reach out more. Mm-hmm. And Nicole's character, the strange catalyst for her to break out of herself is the unexpected connection with the boy who is responsible, unexpectedly, unwittingly responsible for the death of her son. It's a random meeting that could be anything. The playwright really withholds a lot of information, so you don't know what's going on. Is she stalking him? Is she going to kill him? Is she going to
sleep with him?
Love him? Yeah.
That was I think, my first instinct was, it's going to be a...
Is she going to adopt him?
Yeah.
It's... All of those things flow through your mind, and maybe float through her mind, but there's some... You know, they go somewhere where... It's only he that could have saved her.
Yeah.
And vice versa. Only she that could have forgiven him for his non-sin.
Mm-hmm. So do you carry a film like this with you differently as you go through the process of making it and editing it and coming out and publicizing it and all that? Or, I mean, is it harder? Does it weigh on you differently? Or at some point does it become a movie?
There's just less to talk about. You know, it's like with Short Bus, we had many years of developing it with the actors and lots of funny stories. And, you know, with the sexual element brings all kinds of like, oh, what happened? You know, deleted scenes and like, how do you shoot those scenes? You know, an hour's worth of DVD material.
Right.
Same with Hedwig. We had 7 years
that was a lot of
stage
history, yeah,
before the film. And this, it's not going to be any deleted scenes. It's all there. You know, it's like, there's not a lot of kooky stories. We didn't rehearse, you know, nobody killed a child for their rehearsal. You know, this, it's all, it's there. You know, so maybe in a way the challenge is going to be that there's less to talk about and more on the screen.
Mm-hmm. Do the actors do a lot of research on something like this? I mean, is there a way into
they
it?
They really didn't. You know, Aaron went to a group meeting but felt like it was kind of unethical because he was, by being there, was saying, you know, tacitly saying that he had lost a child. He felt terrible.
Yeah.
Nicole requested to come and they said, no, it has to be for... But... Again, this is not a huge imagination process of creating a Hedwig, but you know, a world. This is like an upper middle class world in Queens.
But you wonder if that's harder in some ways, because you don't have, as I was saying before, you don't have the same set of tools to be distracting. You kind of really have to get down to the nitty gritty.
That's wonderful though.
Yeah.
It's all about whether you believe them.
And Sandra Oh has, I think, almost one of the more complicated roles, because finding a tone in somebody going through that experience is must have been very difficult.
Yeah, I think it was kind of harder for her than most. She was supposed to be the wallowing group person, but she's supposed to be also the fun one that Aaron Eckhart's character finally responds to, you know, gets stoned with and has a lot of laughs with. And everything that he's not getting from his wife. And she has to do much more with just a couple of expressions. But I love her expression at the end when everything comes down as it does and she's being left and she has this very wise... Another version of that would be just pure rejection and just... in despondency, and there was a kind of, she's been through all of this, she knows about the grief, she knows about the relationships, and she wishes him well. It's hopefully a film about forgiveness, forgiving yourself, forgiving other people, but not a sappy one, you know. The ending is a hopeful one, but I don't think it's a tacked on happy ending.
Does it change, a picture like this change much for you in post? Or did you kind of know what you were getting?
It did change a lot in post. I mean, but it was more very tiny details, like a matter of frames here and there. It was all about the acting, so one take versus another would change your whole experience of whether you're sympathetic to someone or not. So we needed a lot of time to get in there. And what I call frame fuck. You know, it's like two frames here, not two frames back. Right. Get in perfect frame where the humor and the thing is working. And music was very important. And we went through three different composers who, one of them we lost, one of them was wrong, took some time, and finally are happy with. That's why it took like 6 extra months.
Huh. So that agonizing to go
yeah,
through?
Yeah, it was, because it was so delicate. You know, it's like Nicole's face is so delicate. If you do this, a red mark happens because she's so delicate. We have an emotional scene. You suddenly put a violin on it. You kill the scene.
Yeah.
If it's an emotional one. Maybe it's just a single piano note. You know, we have to try those over and over and over.
So is this the first time you've seen it with an audience? Have you tested it at all, or did you?
We've had just, you know, small 40-person audiences. But here, yeah, this is the real. And it was kind of a revelation.
How
I won't
so?
Say a revelation. I mean, I sensed that people would be moved, but that when the shtick came, when the comedy came, it was quite raucous responses, which was great. You know, we always, I tried to wring every laugh out of it when I was allowed to, and that's super necessary for the audience to just breathe and get ready for the next event. So that was really gratifying, you know. You can tell when they're into it. You can tell when everyone starts shifting. Mm-hmm. But we've been editing for a year to kind of cut out those little things that are slowing us down.
Is it hard to get a read on the when people are feeling emotional about it? I mean, we've had this conversation a few times at the festival where because there are obviously a lot of dramas here, and that it's, you know, so much harder to get a read on the audience in one of these theaters when it's the drama part of it and not the comedy part of it. You know, you either get the laugh or you don't.
I think it's talking.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's talking to them. I would hear a lot of sniffling.
Yeah.
In certain scenes. You can tell when there's ambient this.
Mm-hmm.
And that will almost happen on cue when a moment is not, when you're not engaging them. Like,
right.
Maybe we should cut that moment because you see a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that kind of stuff is very useful. Yeah, I'd love to make a diptych film of the film and then different shots of the audience in real time watching and seeing how one moment can affect, you know, maybe even freezing on that moment and going to different people and seeing how one moment can actually make everyone in the same emotion. That's a magic thing if you can.
Yeah.
Or wildly different. You know, it's just fascinating to me.
Yeah. So do you have any urge to change anything since you've seen
no,
it with the crowd here?
No, the sound wasn't great in the theater, so I couldn't quite hear some lines, but that's just because it's a giant theater.
Yeah.
And we would never really be playing in that size theater in real life.
Right.
So I think it's going to be fine. There's a couple music things I wouldn't mind doing.
Mm-hmm.
But acting-wise, we've gone through it.
So does the sieve. Are you emotional? I mean, you're now have to go through the process of selling the movie and seeing how distribution goes and all of those things. Obviously, you're involved as a director, but are you as a? Do you carry an emotional involvement with that?
I do. You know, it's not really my responsibility,
right?
Because I don't own it. I'm not a producer, but it's important to me that we're in the right place.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we want to get a company that's not flogging another film that's going to be in competition for awards, so they, you know, give us our extra, you know, Nicole push, you know, and some great companies do, and they have. We're a little late in the game.
Right.
But there's enough. We're targeting a couple that we would be very happy with, and the conversations are going great. Maybe today, maybe tomorrow. Very exciting. We had like a late night crazy meeting last night with everybody, and it went really well. So, fingers crossed.
So, are you invested in how it plays? So, a company like, say, IFC, where they're kind of driven by VOD and.
I don't know if this is really. That they're kind of or our
no,
choice.
It's not really their
no,
movie,
it's,
but
they tend to also. They have a certain right cream of the foreign and cream of the more indie stuff.
Yeah.
And they have their pipeline. And I don't remember them doing awards campaigns.
They've done some small ones, but it's also the actor first kind of.
Yeah. I can't remember.
But there are not that many people left. I mean,
the last one, yeah.
New Line is gone. And
I know they did Hedwig. Yeah. Think Films, Short Bus.
Another one that's gone.
But yeah, I mean, it's like the Searchlight's the Focus, the Sony's, and the Weinstein's, Lionsgate. I mean, these are the ones that put muscle behind that, and we've got to make sure that they're still happy with the film as is. And I want to, you know.
Like after you've done all that editing, to have.
Yeah, I mean, there's, you know, as we know, there's people here who don't respect that, and that's very important for me to avoid is scissor hands.
So do you feel, not that we're going to name him, even though he has his scissor hands, famously, do you feel the difference in the distribution universe as a filmmaker at this point? Are you feeling?
Yeah, you know, I've been around, even though I haven't dealt with them all,
yeah.
I've been around enough to know the pitfalls. And then there's some people who are great at distribution but not so good at production. You know, so we avoided that, but they kick ass in marketing.
Right.
And then there's those who, you know, your life is going to be a living hell throughout.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you have some kind of ironclad contractual. And then
even then.
Yeah, even then, for certain people.
Yeah.
I don't even want to go near it.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather just put it out on our own.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the way John Sloss did with the Banksy movie. We did it very well with it.
Yeah.
And raised P&A ourselves.
So for, I mean, does it really come down to, for you, my apartment's not that expensive and, you know,
yeah.
I don't have to do any of these things and you're not going to
push yourself? I really don't. I don't have to do anything I don't want to. That's my lucky situation. I make enough with a little Hedwig here and there. I'm starting to do commercials now. I don't want to spend a year on a movie, something I don't have to do, like
right.
emotionally have to do. I'd much rather teach or go for a commercial or maybe do a TV episode. I'm directing my first TV episode next week for a good show.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I even used to turn those down, but.
So is that an intrigue for you, or is that?
No, I love TV.
To make some money and
it's that's
get a
really
final?
Well. It's opportunity to work with Mike White and Laura Dern on a great show.
That's a good thing.
And I do love the long form of television, and maybe someday I'll be part of that. You know, a lot of people are trying that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm the biggest Wire fan known to man. Battlestar Galactica and Lost.
Mm-hmm. Didn't they want to do a Hedwig series at some point?
No, I don't think a Hedwig series. I don't know if I would want to be in that, but.
Well, they'd have to find the, you know, they'd have to get like Scott Wolf to
play
you.
Yeah. Scott Wolf. Yeah, no, this. But, you know, I think people might be surprised at the things, the subject matter and the variety of style that I love to work with. Because as an actor, I did Broadway musicals, but I did Cassavetes-like films, and I did whimsical Fellini-ish thing. There's all kinds of stuff that I like,
mm-hmm.
and I get bored if I'm doing the same thing.
Well, you're kind of one of those guys that I think people in the indie world are always kind of waiting for. What's gonna sprout next?
I love that. I feel very privileged to be able to do that. You know, I look to people like Todd Haynes and Gus Van Sant for their way of working, which is it's about the work. You know, it's like
yeah.
I was in the Hollywood. I'm just kind of stepping out of the Hollywood thing now,
mm-hmm.
and I might step back in because it's milk and it needs that budget, and I love the story and need to tell it. You know, those two guys. The heart is there.
Well, Todd's doing, you know, HBO now. So
that's right.
And we were talking to Christina about it. It's 5.5 hours long.
Mm.
So you couldn't have done that as a feature anyway.
That's right.
Really.
It's a wonderful experience.
Yeah.
So those guys will always be my models of behavior.
Mm-hmm.
Very pure.
So is there anything percolating in your head as a writer that you want to get out there?
There's something I'm working on about my family, but it probably needs to take some time. You know, it's always hard to write about your family when they're around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, dealing with religion, growing up very Catholic, and you know, being a child in a strange military Catholic family, and there's some animation, there's some weird 3D animation where Limbo is involved, but not the Inception version. Mm-hmm. And I'm adapting this Neil Gaiman script with a writer, a short story called How to Talk to Girls at Parties, and that might be my next thing, or I might just go write for a while. And I'm pretty burnt out, you know, lately. I love that kind of having a couple months to go somewhere and start writing something new.
Yeah. So you're really hoping Rabbit Hole is out this year?
Yeah, I think it would be dumb if it wasn't, because you'd be losing the excitement of the festival. You can't bring it out next fall because it'd be like
a long wait.
You could sort of do it in January and qualify in September, which might be good. I mean, December.
I mean, is it strange for you that there is, as it has been for me, is that there's this kind of remarkable number of films in this festival this year with dead children in them?
Are there?
Yeah, there's, you know, they're, well, Beautiful is obviously one of them, and this one that we were just talking about, What Would Virginia Do? Or What Would Virginia, yeah, I guess it was.
Oh, is that is that Lance Black's?
Yes, Lance Black's.
Yeah,
Black's
I saw that. Have you seen him around?
Huh?
Have you seen him?
He was here earlier, but
But
we were talking to the actors today.
Oh, yeah.
But there, it seems to be like there are four or five films, you know.
Does that have a dead kid in it?
Huh?
Does that have a dead kid in it? The Virginia one?
Yeah. It's one of the things that when her pushes her over the edge.
Right.
But it seems to be like that there's something about, I don't know if it's a cultural moment, I don't know if it's a coincidence. It sounds like this film was completely motivated for you by, you know, something that you were specifically interested in and not a
well,
social...
it was a play
moment.
That, I mean, it was just a pre-existing play.
Yeah,
I mean, I guess you could say the same about last year. I mean, there was Antichrist and there was other, you know...
I don't know, it's just fascinating, because there have been, so many of them have been very good films also.
Oh, yeah.
It's been kind of like...
It's a glut.
You know, this very powerful experience you have to have every day of the festival somehow.
Wow.
And go through it, and yet you're going, well, it was a great film, but I'm exhausted already.
What are your favorite films so far?
Well, I'm a big Never Let Me Go person.
Yeah?
I think that's kind of an epic, metaphoric masterpiece.
I can't wait to see
so
that.
So I'm a huge fan of that, and... after that, it's been, you know, I think your film is one of the stronger films. I think Black Swan has been one of the stronger films.
Did you see that?
Just saw that this morning.
Yeah.
But all very different, you know, pieces. Even a movie like The Dead, which is a John Madden movie, that's kind of a movie. It's not really, as indie as some of the other pictures, but it's, you know, a strong, solid picture. So there have been a lot of really good movies at the festival.
Yeah.
But it's been emotional. It's been you're kind of looking for a comedy.
Right.
Looking for some dancing monkeys or something.
Yeah.
To take you out of it. But I think that was, coming out of the screening of your movie, which I saw at the Lightbox, people were kind of overwhelmed and breathing and trying to figure out what to do with themselves. Mm. It was an interesting, I think critics particularly, people have a hard time placing that sense of that experience.
Yeah.
It's a tough road to go.
Yeah.
So far you've been very happy with the response.
Yeah, it's been very good. I mean, I was a bit numb watching it the first time. Watched again yesterday and relaxed and felt people responding the same way. And I don't think it could have gone better. You know, it's just now about the deals.
Does it change anything for you as a director? It's kind of more of a classic filmmaking sample than...
Well, maybe it would change people's minds about things they might approach me with.
Right.
I remember after Hedwig, it was musicals, and like they wanted me to do Rent and this, and large things in it. And I was like, well, it's not really my taste. And like, but you did Hedwig. I was like, I mean, it's just because there's singing doesn't mean it's this. I want to do it. You know, I'd love to be able to do something in the vein of Network or Doctor Strangelove.
Well, there's not a lot of singing in the world that's quite like Hedwig. I mean, that was a very specific kind of, you know, nothing like it since or before.
Right.
Kind of a special animal.
I know.
And the same with Short Bus. I mean, Short Bus was, you know, I mean, it can make it harder to sell it, I think, because it's just like, how do you describe this outside of talking about the sex?
Right.
You know, it's kind of a fascinating.
People find it slowly. It wasn't that kind of must go, because a lot of people were scared, because there's not many instances of sex being used in a way that's not just faux erotic or erotic, so.
No, it was much more interesting and complex than I think that the, you know, it's a movie with a lot of sex in it, kind of sell.
I know.
You know.
Well, people forget that sex is interesting and complex. Mm-hmm. And funny.
And it was funny. So you're now off to, back to New York? Or
back to New York, yeah. And then to L.A. for that TV show.
And it'll be another new adventure.
Yeah. Whitewater rafting scenes. I don't know how I'm going to shoot them.
Well, that's when I think whitewater rafting. I think
you think John Carver.
That's exactly how I go.